And welcome back to the Macworld Podloft. We're here high atop Macworld Expo at the Macworld booth. And I am joined today by...
My ears are popping. It's
altitude. It's so high out here. I'm joined by Ben Long, author, bon vivant, frequent Macworld contributor, photographer, iPhone jailbreaker, geek, and...
It always comes down to that, doesn't it?
Yeah. Ultimately, it does come down to that. Today, I believe, because of the stuff that we have on the table, we're going to talk about photography.
That's what I thought we'd do. I brought some gizmos.
Good, I love gizmos.
That I think are relevant.
Okay.
And that people should know about. Now, I've got a lot of high-tech gizmos here. We've seen a lot of breakthroughs in the digital camera realm over the last few years, and that's why I decided to go to the most impressive piece of technology I've seen in a while, and that's a new camera strap that I think
really?
You should take a look at. Yeah.
Okay.
Now, there have been a couple of camera straps like this. There are a few different companies making what is really not so much a strap as a camera sling.
Okay.
Now, of course, your usual camera strap is just a loop, and you put it over your shoulder, and you walk around like this all day long, or maybe you put it over the other shoulder, whatever. This is a little bit different. So I'm going to let you try this on.
Really?
So you can get the full
Okay. Well, we'll see if we can get it on
camera. So loop that all the way over your head.
All right.
Okay. And just let it go down to your side like
Should
you
my
normally.
Arm go
yeah,
through
yeah.
Here?
Arm through there.
Okay.
Wait. Are you right or left-handed?
I'm right-handed.
All right. Then go the other side.
I have to go the other way.
Yeah. Yeah.
All right. So once again.
Yeah.
Over the head.
Yeah. This product is called the Luma Loop. That's okay. L-U-M-A Loop. So that can just hang down at your side.
Right.
But at any time, if you notice, it's. This thing slides along the sling, so you can just bring it up and down anytime you want.
Right.
Right. So it slides up the strap, and then when you're done, you just put it down in it, and it hangs there. You're never having to take the strap on and off over your head.
This is cozy. So what does this thing cost?
I knew I forgot something. It's
less than $1,000?
Yeah, it's less than $1,000. This is another cool thing. It attaches with this buckle here, so you can very easily just take it off to put it on a tripod.
We'll show one of the cameras that we have a buckle here,
yeah,
and there's another buckle here. All right.
So it's what I really like about it is it's not, with a normal strap, you're having to take it off your shoulder or you're moving it around. Particularly if you're carrying other bags, it's a drag. This thing, it just slides up and down, and you never actually deal with the strap while you're working with it.
Right.
Some people have concern about the plastic buckle thing here.
Yeah.
If you go to the Lumaloop website, they've got video of one of these supporting 500 pounds of weight.
Uh-huh.
I feel like it's completely secure. I've used these to hold motorcycle bags on my motorcycle at highway speeds, and it's always been fine. So I've been really impressed with this.
One thing I notice about this is that unlike the camera strap that comes with my camera, it does not have my camera's name emblazoned across the strap,
yeah.
So that when my camera is hidden in my coat,
right.
People know that I'm carrying around a multiple $1,000 camera.
Exactly.
So if they, they're trying to pick out the guy to mug, and this would give them no idea.
Yeah, exactly. Another cool thing about this for street shooting and people shooting is the camera can just kind of tuck behind your back and you can walk around and you don't necessarily look like a photographer.
Right.
And then you can very easy just whip it up to start shooting.
Right.
And I don't mean that you're ambushing people and going, ha-ha.
It's
if you're approaching someone to talk to them about maybe shooting a portrait or something, you don't look like, oh, here comes this guy with this camera, what's he up to? You can go up and establish a rapport first, and then the camera comes out very easily.
Okay.
There are a few other companies that make similar things, camera slings. Black Rapid makes something called the R-Strap. There's also the Sun Slinger. Google any of those and you'll find them. And it's a very
different
way of
And also priced under $1,000.
Yeah, they're $50 to $60 to $70.
Okay.
They're in that range.
All right.
Which, given the construction and whatnot, they're very reasonable.
All right. Very nice. What else do you have?
Then, less technical, I brought some cameras.
Okay.
I brought a camera.
All right.
So this, of course, is an SLR. The advantage of an SLR is I'm looking through the same lens that is exposing the camera sensor.
Right.
So I am seeing a very accurate view of what I'm going to see. I'm seeing the effects of anything else I put on the lens.
Mm-hmm.
SLRs, because they're larger, they typically have bigger image sensors than small point-and-shoot cameras.
Right.
That leads to better image quality, both in terms of noise, dynamic range, and a lot of other things. And, of course, the other advantage of most SLRs is you can remove the lenses,
right.
Which means you can choose exactly the type of optics that you want to be working with.
Right.
Downside to an SLR is it's big and heavy.
Yeah.
So you're weighing between this and a point and shoot, and, you know, well, the thing about the point and shoot is maybe I take an image quality hit, I can't change the lenses, but I'll carry it everywhere.
Right.
This is a pretty much an entirely new category of camera. This is built around a new standard, or not so new, but a newish standard called Micro Four Thirds.
Okay.
Panasonic, Olympus, Kodak, some other vendors have all agreed upon this standard. And what it is it's a nice halfway point between a full-on SLR and a tiny point-and-shoot camera. First of all, it's very small, very light. I do have interchangeable lenses.
Okay.
The reason the camera is smaller than an SLR is that there's no mirror inside.
All right.
That's just the sensor right there, which means that without a mirror, I don't get the fancy optical viewfinder that I have up here. So the camera is a live view camera. You use the LCD as the viewfinder.
And how good is that? Because generally I'm disappointed in the quality of most of those things.
There are trade-offs to an LCD viewfinder. Using it in bright light is going to be difficult.
Right.
Trying to do landscape shooting with it on a bright day, you're not going to see it. There's another disadvantage that may take you a while to discover, which is the LCD does not have the full dynamic range when you're using it as a viewfinder that your final image is going to have.
Okay.
And certainly doesn't have the dynamic range that your eye has.
Right.
So if I'm wanting to build a composition off of some elements that are in shadow, it might well be that I look at the image and those shadows have gone just completely dark.
Yeah.
And then you go, well, but I thought there was something in there. Oh, there is a thing there. I just can't see it on here. And it can sometimes confuse you when you're composing and you kind of got to look back
right.
and forth. The advantage of it is it shows absolute 100% coverage of your final scene.
Okay.
You get full status displays on the back.
Right.
If you're used to shooting with an LCD viewfinder on a point-and-shoot camera, that's the experience you're going to have here.
Right.
Stupidly, I forgot to bring it. There's also a little clip-on LCD viewfinder for this camera that goes on top.
Oh, it's an LCD viewfinder.
It's an LCD viewfinder.
Okay.
So you can at least have this experience of blocking out the rest
right.
of the world. That solves the shooting in sunlight problem.
Okay.
The reason it's an LCD is because there's no mirror in here.
Right.
So LCD is all you're going to have on something like this.
Okay.
The Olympus Micro Four Thirds cameras, for certain lenses, they actually have an optical viewfinder that you can clip on here. They only work with those specific lenses because
right.
they can't zoom and that sort of thing. So the advantages of this are very small size, extremely good image quality.
Mm.
It's a larger sensor than what you get in a point-and-shoot. It's not as big as what you're going to have
right.
in a full-on SLR, but it's a larger sensor. Working at ISO 1600 on this camera in low light is great.
Oh,
it's
really?
Every okay. bit as good as a digital SLR of just one generation ago.
Right.
And I still get my lens choices. Because the sensor is smaller and because the lens, there's no mirror in the way, so the lens is much closer to the focal plane,
right.
lenses can be made very small. This is a 14 to 42 millimeter zoom lens.
Yeah.
That's an equivalent. All Micro Four Thirds have a 2x focal length multiplier. If you want to know what the equivalent of this is in 35 millimeter terms, this is an 18 to 84.
Okay.
So it's very small. When it's zoomed out all the way, it gets a little bit larger. But still, even on the camera, this stays a very nice small lens. So even with a hefty zoom or a mid-size zoom lens,
yeah,
this is
it's
still
only that big.
Yeah, it's still a very reasonable size, and you're not taking a big quality hit.
Right.
There's a very nice range of lenses out. Because it's a standard, you can interchange lenses that Olympus is making, Panasonic,
right.
a lot of other vendors. For example, this is a 20 millimeter lens, which is going to be an equivalent 40. So it's
right.
going to be just about a normal lens on a 35 millimeter camera. F1.7, so it's a very fast lens,
right.
but as you can see, very, very small when it's on the camera.
And do these shoot video as well?
They do shoot video.
HD or standard def?
It depends on, it varies right. from one to the other. This is, I'm pretty sure this, I have not actually done a lot of video with this camera. I'm pretty sure it's the ADVHC.
Right,
I get dyslexic when I think about those. It's got a very full feature set. I get program, full priority modes, full manual modes, a decent assortment of scene modes. I really like the interface. This also has a reasonable pop-up flash.
Okay.
It's got a hot shoe for an external flash or the optical viewfinder. auto bracketing. It's actually got some features that I wish I had on my fancy SLR.
Yeah.
Custom scene modes and all sorts of other stuff.
So who is this for? This is because what the price of these is, what, 800 to
800 bucks with a lens.
Yeah.
Again, it's an in-between point.
Yeah.
If you are working with a point-and-shoot camera and you're thinking, you know, I feel like I'm running into the limitations. I would like to be shooting raw because I want the advantages of raw
right.
shooting, the ability to adjust white balance later and recover overblown highlights and that kind of thing.
Right.
If you're feeling like I'm doing a lot of night shooting and I'm tired of my images being really noisy, having those awful grain patterns, and you've been thinking maybe I should go to an SLR, but you know, I just don't feel like I'd carry it around,
right.
This might be a fine alternative.
Okay.
If you're already an SLR shooter and you're thinking, I always carry a point and shoot also because I want, you know, there are times when I'm going to the symphony tonight. I can't take my SLR with me, but I'll take this little point and shoot. Well, this will still, with a small lens, fit in your pocket.
Right.
So it's a halfway point that you can come to from either side.
Okay.
I actually, there have been times where I've gone, you know what, I'm gonna just try it. I'm gonna take this instead of the SLR, and it's been fine.
Oh, terrific.
Yeah.
Okay.
You're not gonna want to go out and, again, do lots of heavy landscape shooting mm-hmm. or shoot fast-moving sports or nature kind of things with it, but for most of the kinds of shooting you do, it's a reasonable alternative at
okay,
a much
and this
smaller
is a
size.
Popular enough format that we have lens makers are thinking, yeah, we want to give you a wide-angle lens and a fisheye lens and all these special feature lenses.
Well, actually, there's two. First of all, the Micro Four Thirds thing is just really on fire right now.
Okay.
It's Olympus has now three models out. Panasonic has these. The other thing is, somehow just right away, people started manufacturing adapter rings. So you can put, I can put these lenses on this camera. But if you've got an older collection of Leica lenses mm-hmm. Or any of the small rangefinder cameras of old, there's probably adapters to use those lenses already.
Great.
Which means there have been a lot of vendors who've been very quickly able to get their lens collections on. So yes, you can get everything from fisheye lenses to tilt shift lenses mm-hmm. for doing architectural photography.
Right.
Between the two of them, Olympus and Panasonic have a wider range of lenses. One thing to note is those two companies have taken different approaches to stabilization.
Mm-hmm.
The Olympus camera has a stabilized sensor, meaning any camera that you put, any lens that you put on it is going to be stabilized.
Right.
Panasonic has taken the lens-based stabilization approach.
Mm-hmm.
So I have an Olympus lens on here right now, so I don't have any stabilization. I could put a Panasonic lens on here and end up with stabilized lenses. So that's kind of also a trade-off if you're trying to choose, but it also means that there's this wide assortment of some lenses that are stabilized and some that aren't. So yeah, there's a very big lens supply right now.
Good.
The only downside at the moment is the stuff's in short supply. It's
right.
selling so well, it's hard to get a hold of.
Nice. But okay, so for the one guy who will appear in our forums and say, what is this photo? This is Macworld. Where's the Mac angle here? I'm just going to switch topics.
Oh, him.
Him. That
okay.
that guy.
Right.
Aperture 3 just came out.
It did.
Why should I care? What is it about it that I should be thrilled about?
First of all, I should say, if you're using any of these cameras, you should not be thrilled about it.
There's not supported yet.
Yeah.
Hmm.
excuse me. What Aperture brings that the longtime Aperture user has been waiting for from the first version is true selective editing power.
Right.
And by selective editing, I mean I take a shot of you up against a bright window and you've fallen into shadow. I would like to brighten up just your face without brightening the rest of the image. Mm-hmm. I can go in with a brush and paint on your face and paint a brightening adjustment in.
Right.
So I get the ability to apply most of Aperture's edits by brushing them on.
Okay.
Those can also be combined with global edits still.
Right.
So that's the for the serious photographer, that's the killer new feature in Aperture and the reason to upgrade. There's a whole lot of other stuff in there also. A lot of iPhoto's features have been ported into Aperture. You now get the facial recognition stuff, the geotagging stuff,
right.
so that I can view all my images on a map. There are, actually, if you go to the Aperture page on Apple's website, you'll find a full list of the 200-plus new features. And, of course, some of them are, you know, we changed the color of this interface widget. But there's just lots and lots of stuff all the way around. And you never know which one might be, you know, that's the thing I've been waiting for.
Yeah,
the fact
yeah.
that I can see the focus spot that my camera chose when I was shooting. Or the fact that I can now move projects around in the library. Or another big one that a lot of people have complained about, I can change Aperture libraries without having to quit and relaunch the application. There's gobs and gobs of stuff like that. So if you're a longtime Aperture user, there are a lot of reasons to upgrade.
What if you're a Lightroom user and you're thinking, well, is this enough to pull me? Because they seem to be having this little tug of war that Aperture's out and people go, this is great. Oh, but wait, Lightroom, I'm going to... Because they're both inexpensive enough that you can actually jump between the two.
You can if you manage your expectations.
Okay.
Because if you're going to be moving your images between the two, you're going to pay a price in terms of this whole non-destructive thing that you chose one of these programs for in the first place.
Right.
Being built around Photoshop Camera Raw, Lightroom... your non-destructive edits, and by non-destructive edits, I mean when I choose to do something to an image, I'm not actually altering any pixels in the image.
Right.
I'm simply, the program is listing those edits in a little list and applying them in real time to my original master image data. Adobe has chosen to store that list of edits alongside the document.
Mm-hmm.
In Aperture, it's tied up in the Aperture library, so I can't get that information out.
Right.
So if I do some edits in Aperture and want to move to Lightroom, I have to bake the edits.
Right.
Take it over. Then if I do some edits in Lightroom, I have to bake those and bring them back. So it's better to choose one and stick with it.
But is Aperture compelling enough that you think some Lightroom users will say, you know, I really am not getting exactly everything I want from Lightroom, so off I go to Aperture and I'll continue working in Lightroom for those images that exist, but new images I will bring into Aperture.
And you just hit it on the head there. That's if you're heavily invested in Lightroom, you're not going to say, great, I'll migrate my whole thing into Aperture.
Right.
Because if you do, you're going to lose a bunch of editability.
Right.
So you're going to be maintaining that and then starting anew. I would say that's a question that just people need to answer for themselves, which they can do for free. There's a free Aperture trial download that you can get off of Apple's website. You can install it, move some images into it, see what you think about the editability. I would say that Apple's done a very good job of adding the editability that's been missing from Aperture.
Mm-hmm.
Whether there's some great new thing there that's going to make you learn an entire new thing. I mean, it's not just about migration, it's about learning curve and so on and so forth.
And it's a different workflow.
It's a different workflow. And Aperture still has, in terms of workflow, still has an edge over Lightroom in terms of Aperture is very non-modal.
Mm-hmm.
I can edit a bunch of images and throw them into a book and be editing the book and laying it out and doing things and go, oh, you know, this image actually still needs a white balance adjustment. I hit the F key and boom, I'm in an editing mode and I do things. I hit it again, boom, and I'm back out and I'm editing my book.
Yeah.
It's really nicely non-modal. Some people really like working that way. Some people feel lost and adrift without having a nice structure imposed upon them that Lightroom has. So it's six of one, half dozen of another, depending on the way that you need to work. It's great that they're out there competing against each other, dragging each other along.
Yeah.
I don't know that, and you know, if you're an Aperture user right now, you might want to go look at the Lightroom beta because it's is that reason enough to switch? You're talking about when you adopt one of these programs, you're committing.
Yeah, yeah. Now, are either one of these programs drawing away from Photoshop because that was the big tool everybody used for so long?
Excuse me. It's a complicated choice right now where you should go.
Yeah.
I mean, and we're leaving out other things like iPhoto or Nikon Capture NX or any of these other mm-hmm. programs that are workflow tools and editors. With CS4, Adobe raised the stakes by adding a lot of nice workflow features to Bridge.
Right.
I can now do cataloging in Bridge, which was the thing that was missing before, that I would have to go to an external program like Microsoft Expression
mm-hmm.
Or Extensis Portfolio. Now it can kind of do that. So the Bridge, Camera Raw, Photoshop combination is one choice. Lightroom is another.
Yeah.
Aperture is another. It really, really depends on the way that you like to work. If you are heavily invested in an organizational scheme inside the Finder, and you've got a lot of drives and you really like the way you've got things organized, then Photoshop Bridge is probably a good way to go.
Yeah.
If you go, I don't want to spend $500 on an editor, Lightroom and Aperture are so cheap. Well, there's Photoshop Elements, which is $89, and you get Bridge. And
right.
So that's a very affordable Photoshop solution. Adobe's definitely got a very cluttered product line right now. That's or you could look at it as, we have this wonderful freedom of choice to choose from among five different options.
Yeah.
What I like about, and maybe another way to decide it is, do you move your images around to a lot of different places?
Yeah.
Does Aperture and Lightroom provide all of the image editing power that you need? If not, and you're feeling like, well, I want to go into Photoshop because I like these particular plugins and they're not available. Or I like I do a lot of panoramas and want to stitch them. Or I regularly deliver images to a pre-press environment where I need CMYK conversions. Or to a laboratory that's going to do scientific analysis. Any of the other things that Photoshop can do.
Yeah.
If you're heavily invested in moving images into Photoshop, you might be better off staying away from Lightroom and Aperture and just using Bridge. If you rarely go into Photoshop, then you're not going to have a big workflow hassle moving out of one of those other programs, and maybe either one of those is a self-contained alternative.
Okay.
Well, I see we are out of time because I'm looking off into the distance. It's just there's a clock there.
Oh, my gosh. It's bearing down on us.
But we have to wrap it up. So where can people go for more information about what you do and your photography?
They can go to my website at www.completedigitalphotography.com. They can get free trial downloads of any of the things we've been talking about from the relevant vendor websites, and that's worth doing. Right. I mean, that's a really great thing that you can actually just download a fully functional version of any of these things and try them out. That might be the easiest way to answer all of these questions.
Okay, terrific. Thanks very much for joining me, Ben.
Thank you, Chris.